My name's Tom Green, and Professor Bivin has given me permission to present this data I collected on my last job.
Thanks, Tom.
Woo! This is Mesa Verde National Park. Really cool place to visit. Next slide, please. What is interesting is in the past couple of years, a lot of forest fires have been sweeping through the park. Next slide, please. And over half the park has burned in the last 10 years. So this creates a huge disturbance, and we collected data to try and understand what's taking place. So just in a quick summary, these three fires kind of represent our study plots. In just a two-year period, over 55% of the park is burned. And this is pinyon juniper woodland. It's an old-growth habitat, and it will take like hundreds of years for this forest to recover. And so if the park is burning this quickly, you can extrapolate and realize, well, the forest isn't going to rejuvenate fast enough. Maybe what we're witnessing is a shift to a different kind of ecosystem. So that's why we collected this data, is to understand this process. So this is what ecologists look at. It's a succession cycle, and it's based on disturbance. So if you're in ecosystem, your mature ecosystem is a forest, and then a disturbance hits, whether it's a hurricane or a wildfire, it kind of acts as a reset button. And the process starts with small plants like grasses and herbs. And then over time, shrubs will start growing, and that'll start a younger woodland, and then different species of trees will slowly take over. And that's the story anyways, but nobody's really studied this for pinyon juniper woodlands. So this is what a PJ forest looks like after it's been burned. And so all the old dead trees, and now it's predominantly a grassland with maybe a few shrubs that sprouted back after the fire. What's interesting here also are the horses, and then there's a couple of elk in the top left corner there. So horses are not native to this ecosystem. They haven't been, for thousands of years, they haven't been here. The elk are native. So this is one thing that ecologists look at is, we call these exotic animals and those native animals. And you can do the same with plants. You can consider plants exotics or natives too, and they can do different ecological problems. So we're trying to understand that. So our methods, we used GIS to create these random locations that fit specific characteristics, like is the land flat, does it have the right community that burned, did the burn happen within a certain time frame? So we gave it fixed parameters, but it randomly generated where the plots are located. Then each year we would go out at the same time and measure these plots. So we would capture some of the physical characteristics that aren't likely to change, like the location of the plot will never change. The slope, how steep of a slope does it have? Which way is it pointed north or is it pointed south? That's the aspect. And that's in degrees of north or south. So those shouldn't change year to year, but other data is expected to change, like what species are growing there. So this is some of the data. Each entry, each record in our data is designated by a year and a plot ID. So you can kind of consider that a unique identifier of each piece of data. And then we collected all the different species that are growing there, and I lumped them together into functional groups so you don't have to worry about understanding the species. So native grass, exotic grass, we would go along a transect line, we would count all the number of species that are grass, all the species that are forbs, and mark whether it's exotic or native. You tally it up, and then I created a percentage, if that's easier to work with in the statistics instead of the absolute number. You can take your pick from the data, which you prefer. So I split them between grasses and forbs, and I also split them between natives and exotics, because those are interesting ecological questions to ask. I split out one species in particular, cheatgrass, which is, its acronym is BroTech, Bromus tectorum. And it's perhaps the most important thing to track for wildfires. It's an invasive species, so it's ecologically considered disturbance. So it's an important one to look at. and I, you know, this is my own bias, is I suspect it might be driving some of these other measurements. In case you're not familiar with what a forb is, this is just a picture of what forbs are. They're just leafy plants that are wildflowers that aren't woody vegetations like shrubs or trees. This is a list of the data fields that are out there. So bare ground, litter, and rock, I didn't lump those into a functional group. You might consider lumping those three parameters into one called no cover or dead stuff. The horse count is just a measurement of how frequently we saw evidence that horses were in the area. So you can just kind of consider that a coefficient of horse activity. The eastings and northings, so UTM coordinates are just by meters. So when you look at a UTM of the northing, that's how many meters north it is of a fixed point. So you can use that as a gradient. So the like one of the groups of data you have are five different groups that are based on the northing values. So the highest values are the northernmost ones. The furthest ones south have a lower value. And that could be important because as the mesa dips down, it's losing elevation. So there's like a 400-foot elevation change between the northernmost one and the southernmost one. And that could cause changes in rainfall, how long or severe the winters feel to the plant. So that could be an important characteristic to check. And then slope and aspect, those could factor in as well. If it's facing north on a slope, it's going to have cooler weather than something that's facing south on a slope. So those are other parameters that you might want to check for correlations and data. The crust percent, so there's in the high deserts, it's called cryptobiotic soil, or crust for short. And it's kind of a way to check, they're like mosses and lichen, and they typically grow in undisturbed areas. So the higher the crust percentage, the more likely we're looking at intact or undisturbed areas. Not necessarily, and so that's why that's out there, is it might be an interesting trend to see, well, if we have high crust percentage, does that mean there's a high species diversity? And diversity is kind of measured by richness, and I'll explain that in more detail, but richness total is probably the one that's most interesting to you. It'll be a list of all the species we uniquely found within the plot. So this is what the plot looks like, and these are the nested plot areas that are listed. So I broke them out, 1 meter square, 6 meter square, 12 meter square. So what we would do is we'd start counting all the unique species in the first plot, jump to the next one, and then anything unique in that one, we'd start counting individually and so on, and create those richness totals. So you can look at them either by these subplots in the relative area, or you might want to just consider the richness total, which is the whole plot. And so these are the two different groups of data, the northing sets and that I explained earlier that are just based on that UTM northing value, and then the mesa sets, which are based on the name of the mesa that the plots were in. So that's, you can almost think of that as a east to west gradient, but they're just different geographical units to compare the data. So those are just some that it might turn out to be superficial grouping, but just a way to kind of compartmentalize the data and test. So some of the ideas that were just bouncing through my head, you know, it's a little early to answer some of the long-term questions that the study's designed for, but there's a lot of short-term questions that I'm really hoping this class full of expert statisticians can start helping to see if there's really cool things in the data, such as, is there a change year to year in the diversity of the plots? Are the plots getting more or less diverse? Are grasses taking over? Are forbs taking over? Are the exotics or horses taking over? But things you need to be aware of is this real life data. This, no guarantees that the standard deviations are going to be equal. The normality of the data could be strange. The ways to group data, you might want to totally, we've got those initial groupings, but maybe that's not the right way to think about it. Maybe we should, if you look at the data, there's fire names, which is the name of the fire that caused the disturbance. And they happened at different years, and there's different variables that are associated with that, such as the intensity of the fires, how the treatments were done after the fire. So there's a set of variables that are different. Maybe the fire names would be a better way to group the data. One of the things you need to be aware of is 2011, that's the first year of the data, but that was the pilot year, and some of the plots that were created we decided to exclude from the data set. The Bircher fire was in that data set, and there was some confusing extraneous data, and we decided to drop those, and we added other sets. So maybe 2011 is going to add some confusion to the data. You might want to just consider dropping that year altogether, or it might provide something interesting to compare. The remaining years, 2012, 13, 14, those all should have the same number of plots. But 2011, the plot names, you know, there's going to be some plots that aren't in the later data sets, and there's going to be plots that were in 2011 and not in the others. But I'm really, you know, these are the biases. Point number four is just things that I'm thinking of. You know, the idea is maybe Bromus tectorum is to blame for a lot of these problems. So if that's increasing, maybe diversity is decreasing. All these other biases that I have when I look at this data and I'm thinking about, but maybe y'all can have a look at this data and come up with new approaches, you know, just post hoc the crap out of it and see if you find some correlations that an ecologist wouldn't even necessarily think of. So I really appreciate you taking a look at this data and wish you lots of luck. Thank you.
Rad. Nice work. Post-hoc the crap out of it.
Post-hoc the crap out of it.